On behalf of Edelweiss, let me welcome you all to the Q4 FY18 earnings call of VIP Industries. From the management today, we have Mr. Dilip Piramal, the CMD, Ms. Radhika Piramal, the Vice Chairman and Executive Director, and Mr. Jugendra Sethi, the CFO of VIP. So without any further ado, I'll hand over the call to Mr. Dilip Piramal for his initial comments, post which we'll open the floor for Q&A. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. It is my great pleasure to welcome you this afternoon. We have had a very good year and a very good quarter. And during the quarter four, the company achieved income from operations of ₹362.57 crores against 312.88 crores in the corresponding quarter of the previous year, registering a growth of 16%. Consequent to introduction of GST, several indirect taxes, including central excise and VAT, have been subsumed into GST. And as per the new accounting standards, revenue has to be reported net of GST VAT and inclusive of excise duty. Hence, results for the current quarter and last quarter are not absolutely comparable. GST for Q4 was higher by around 12 crores as compared to VAT in the previous corresponding quarter. Under IND AS, net scheme discounts of around 3 crores have been netted off from sales during Q4 FY18, which used to be included in other income during previous year. Hence, there is a total difference of about 15 crores. In that case, total revenue would have been ₹377 crores, a growth of around 21% for quarter 4 FY18 against reported sales growth of around 16%. For the year ended 31st March 2018, the company achieved income from operations of 1,416 crores against 1,282.5 crores in the previous year, registering a growth of around 10%. For majority of the call, I will be referring to our consolidated financials. For quarter 4, sales growth was achieved from domestic business as international growth business growth is negative. Domestic growth is mainly volume growth. I would now like to talk about our brands. The Skybags brand is growing very well. Skybags is also the leading brand for backpacks. The VIP brand is also growing very well. We have started advertising Aristocrat brand on television. Aristocrat's latest collection has been well received and sale of Aristocrat is growing steadily. Carlton brand also has shown good growth in quarter four. And right now you might be observing we are having a very intense campaign for the Carlton brand. Caprizi, our ladies handbag brand, is also doing well and grown well during the quarter and margins also are quite good. During the quarter, all channels have done extremely well. Modern trade and general trade channel also are growing well in spite of high base. E-commerce channel is also growing well. Now I would like to talk about the profitability. Our EBITDA was at ₹56.74 crores for the quarter, up from 31.73 crores, a growth of about 79%. Overall, our EBITDA was at 15.6 in quarter four, as compared to 10.1 in quarter four of last year, which is a significant improvement. EBITDA has improved due to higher gross contribution. Gross contribution has improved due to product mix and strong rupee. Advertisement and marketing expenses were around 6%. Basically, what happens when the sales growth is more than 10%, then the gross margin kicks in, and that takes up all the margins quite higher. For the year ended 31st March 2018, our EBITDA was at ₹202.76 crores, up from ₹139.83 crores. That is a growth of about 45%. Overall, our EBITDA is 14.3 for the year as compared to 10.9 for the last year, which is a good improvement. Our profit before tax for quarter four was 53.12 crores, up from 28 crores during quarter four last year, which is a growth of 89%. For the year ended 31st March 2018, our profit before tax was at ₹189.6 crores. Up from 125.5 crores during the previous year, which is a growth of around 50%. As also, our PAT is also grown at 51%. Fixed overheads are well under control. During the FY 2017-18, two new subsidiaries have been incorporated in Bangladesh, One manufacturing facility under VIP Industries BD Manufacturing Private Limited has commenced production during March 2018. Hence, VIP Industries has three subsidiaries in Bangladesh. And the reason to have so many subsidiaries is that we get a tax concession for 5 years, and that is given company-wise. And one good thing about Bangladesh is that the 5 years, the first year starts only after we start commercial production. So we actually get the full 5 years benefit. VIP Bangladesh, now combined 300% subsidiaries, had income from operations of 19.8 crores during the last quarter against 15.9 crores in the corresponding quarter last year, a growth of 24.5%. Income from operations for the year ended 31st March 2018 were 57 crores as compared to 49 crores in the previous year, growth of 15.4%. Profit after tax for Bangladesh was for quarter four was 3.2 crores as compared to 3.3 crores during the last quarter. For the year ended March 2018, profit after tax for VIP Bangladesh was at 9.5 crores, up from 8.3 crores during the previous year, which is a growth of around 14.5%. And now we are paying tax at 50% of the profits for the first factory, which was the main production last year. This year, the other two factories will also kick in gradually over the year. One general observation I would like to make is that for if you see our profit after tax CAGR for the last 5 years, it amounts to 32.1%. 32.1% CAGR tantamounts to a profit growing four times in 5 years and three times in 4 years, which I think is a very good achievement. And I hope that for the next 5 years, our target is to maintain this, and I'm quite confident that we will achieve this. That is, increase our profits by, multiply our profits by four times in 5 years or three times in 4 years. With this, I now open the floor to any questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin with a question answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handset while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while a question queue assembles.
While the queue assembles, can I check, is there any disturbance now?
No, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
We take the first question from the line of Chirag Lodhia from ValueQuest. Please go ahead.
Hi. Congratulations on very good set of numbers. My first question is on growth. So if you can help,
can you speak in the mic a little bit, please?
Yeah. So what is the adjusted growth for full year FY18?
Adjusted growth? You mean after the taxes and all?
Yeah. GST and this discounts.
Yes.
Being
I think it would be 18%, right, Radhika?
Yeah, I'm just going to give that.
Okay. And
16.5%.
16.5%. Okay. Secondly, on how is overall competitive intensity now with American Tourister relaunch and Chameleon doing very well? Safari is also growing at very good rate. So how you see overall competitive intensity vis-a-vis how market as an industry is shaping us? Because if you look at your number per se, last four quarters we are seeing growth rates are moving up, inching up quarter on quarter. So how one should look at this overall industry growth vis-a-vis competitive intensity shaping up?
Radhika, shall I answer that?
Yeah, as you like, yes.
Yeah, I'll say and then you can add something, yeah?
Sure.
I want to tell you something, sort of another overview about, I spoke about the five-year CAGR.
Mm-hmm.
I think right now our company is in a very strong position market-wise.
Mm-hmm.
Market share is highest in so many years. There is no doubt that some of our one competitor has the smaller one has taken some market share, but I think it has come more at the expense of the second leader. And all our brands are doing extremely well. I mean, this is I've been in this business for so long, and all four of our luggage brands, that is Carlton, VIP, Skybags, and Aristocrat, are performing well. Even Caprizi brand is performing well.
Right.
So we have all round. In fact, we are quite strong in most areas of our operation. Our international sales has never been a very important aspect in the last 3-4 years. They have been quite weak, and they continue to be weak.
Right.
And there are some headwinds on the canteen stores in this coming year, in the present current year.
Mm-hmm.
But last year was pretty okay. So I feel that we have been, we are on a very strong wicket. Let me also add that our Indian economy is doing extremely well, and especially non-consumer goods, non-FMCG sector, you know, where the penetration is not so high. In FMCG, the penetration is about 60%, whereas in our category, the penetration is hardly 20%. So all these industries are doing extremely well. Aviation is doing very well, and that is a direct bearing on our business. So we have very strong tailwinds. Not only the luggage industry, but most such industries which rely on discretionary income. And then the performance of each company depends on its competitive strength.
Correct.
So I feel today we are in a very sweet spot on both these aspects,
mm-hmm.
that the overall economy is doing performing very well. GST and has been a great boon to us, and it will strengthen the formal economy. And generally the economy, you know, like I would like to comment that this insolvency resolution, the bankruptcy code and all, it's a very good thing for the economy.
Right.
So I feel that the general economy is doing well and our competitive strength is very good. So I'm very positive about the outlook.
Okay. So can you add a little bit on the CHD? What happened on FY18 full year basis to CHD sales and how...
Okay, let me explain to you very broadly. The canteen stores department is an arm of the defense ministry, and it was set up 50 years ago for the civil requirements of the defense department of the armed forces. And in the frontier areas, you know, there is no civil retail shops and all are not there, and it's very sparsely populated.
Mm-hmm.
Over the years, this canteen stores has increased tremendously. And by the way, everything is this, this is my opinion, because, you know, in government departments, they don't give official, any sort of guidelines or plans. So this is what I generally feel, and it is correct also, from the market information we get. One of the biggest advantages in the canteen stores is that they charge only a 5% markup from the manufacturer.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't make any profit, and the land and everything is free, particularly in the frontier agency areas, as well as even in cities, you know, like...
True.
So there is no... The distribution cost is virtually nothing as compared to about 40% on the selling price, on the MRP of 100.
Mm-hmm.
Our distribution costs are nearly about 40%.
Right.
And then they also have the advantage in most states, the sales tax used to be exempted. Now I think about 50% of that is exempted.
Right.
So over the years, it has become a very, very cheap source of consumer goods for the armed forces. Now the feeling in the government is that with distribution being so good in the metropolitan cities,
mm-hmm.
there is no need to for the government to make this sacrifice on the VAT on taxes.
Correct.
Because as it is, they are getting it quite cheap.
Correct.
And the whole purpose is to serve the armed forces. I think in some areas there is a lot of leakage also, meaning that the normed armed forces also get it. I'm not sure, but I think in the liquor and all, where the taxes also are very high, so some of the taxes are exempt. Like excise duty is not exempt anywhere, whether it was our goods or liquor. And now, of course, it's 50% of the GST is supposed to be excise. So there is no, the government feels that there is no reason to subsidize the armed forces so much, you know, and there's a lot of people agree that this is just a giveaway from the government.
Right.
And also the now these large stores, discount stores have come up. So basically retailing also has become very competitive. So the consumer anyway is getting a good good deal because of the super hyper competition and the, particularly the hypermarkets and all that. So the general feeling is that this should now remain, the CSD should function more for the actual armed forces and maybe more get away from the metropolitan cities. So from time to time they change their policies, but I have, we've seen one last year that many of the retail shops of the, what they are called canteens, the retail shops are called canteens by the defense forces, that they are become quite bare, means B-A-R-E, bare, empty, and there is hardly any goods. The last quarter was good. But, so, and there's a lot of uncertainty because they don't give any guidelines that how, what we are going to do and all.
Right.
So, there's a lot of uncertainty, but one thing is for sure that they are winding down. Not, they're not winding up totally. Means they are sort of reducing their operations in certain areas. Like at one time they used to sell vehicles also, motor vehicles.
Correct.
And again, that was just a tax advantage and all. But then the tax, then everyone started objecting that what is the sense in selling vehicles and all.
So going ahead, we don't see this as a growth channel for us at least.
Yes, yes. But in fact, we are seeing this as an opportunity, you know, that we would like to really, and overall for all the companies, maybe except one exception, the market share of the CSD business is, I mean, the total composition of the sales of CSD is coming down, especially for our company. And I think also for
any
the...
Any specific reason just for our company?
Means I'm talking about my company because I know information about that. I don't want to comment. But I think for everybody it is coming down.
Okay.
It would be fair to say for everybody. I don't want to comment too much about other companies.
Just one question on this gross margins. So if I look at your gross margin quarter on quarter, sequentially vis-a-vis YOY, we have seen very good improvement in your gross margins. And now in last 3-4 months, we have seen rupee, yuan, currency movements turning back, so which are not in favor to us. So how...
Okay, let me explain that to you. See, the rupee, yuan is a very small percentage, you know, of the cost. I mean, it's not even... if it's gone up from 64 to 67, it's about, it is 5% increase in the, but when our gross margin is so high, then the total impact of the product is not so much.
No, can I jump in here?
On, we can pass it on also.
May I jump in here?
Just one second, Radhika. So that is not so important, as what happens is when the overall sales growth is high, we've had very good sales growth, you know, over 15%. So then the whole gross margin comes in. Gross margin is over 30%. The fixed costs remain at about 10%. Yeah. So that 20% delta is there, and that add increases the EBITDA. So in all such companies where gross margin is nearly 50%, in some cases it's even more than that in some industries, Where the sales go up, then the overall profits increase. And also when sales go down, then they can sort of deteriorate quite badly, the margins. Yeah, Radhika, now you can say.
To answer the specific question on why the gross margin has improved quarter on quarter, two reasons. One is, you know, the revenue base is less because of this restatement post-GST, pre-GST. So if we had had the old reporting system, our sales would have been slightly higher, you know. As we said earlier, our sales growth would have been 16%, revenues would have been 377 instead of that 366.
So about 1.5%.
And so as a percentage, it would have been a bit lower. So that's one reason. The second is, genuinely, our gross margins have improved.
If I take your revenue base as 375 instead of 363, my gross margins actually go up. Because my cost is fixed.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so
No, but so our gross margins are also higher. The reason for that is we took some price increases last year.
Mm-hmm.
And this, when you say rupee yuan, let's do rupee dollar, okay, because that's what we pay in. We pay in dollars, not yuan.
Right.
That has not flowed through yet because we buy inventory in advance, right? We have a long lead time from China. So we have 3-4 months of inventory.
Okay.
So this depreciation that we are seeing now, which I agree started about, you know, 1 or 2 months ago, that will actually flow through in Q1, not in Q4. Because of Q4, you know, we had purchased and booked all that at an earlier time.
Right. So is it fair to assume Q1 will see some gross margin pressure because of currency movements?
It will, and not only because of currency, but because raw materials have also increased. Not only rupee has depreciated, there's been the first FOB actual finished goods price increase from China after many, many years that we had to give. Plastic prices are up. So we gave all those price increases sort of for our, you know, April, May, June inventory.
Mm-hmm.
So starting from December. So there is some pressure, but we did take price increases. We took 3 price increases last year. We are evaluating whether we need to take another price increase this year. So, I mean, the goal is to try and maintain the current margins. There's maybe some pressure to erode. Let us see if we can try and maintain. Further improving from this will definitely be challenging.
So 3 price increase quantum, put together quantum would be in the range of?
It would have been high last year, like 8 to 10%. We cannot take such a big price increase again.
And just one last question on operating leverage. So we have seen 16-17% top line growth for full year. And when I look at your gross margins, they are up by 350 bps. At the same time, our operating margins are just up by 320 bps. So we have not seen any operating leverage kicking in the numbers. So how one should look at it going ahead also?
Well, we are investing in the business. I mean, I think it is a good philosophy to invest in your sales growth. So we are spending a little bit more on advertising. We are spending a little bit more on people. But you say operating has not grown, but our EBITDA is much higher than it was this time last year. So
it's all because of gross margin. So just wanted to understand the fixed cost nature of the business. So it is also growing at the same pace vis-a-vis top line. So how
at this point, we are investing in all our brands. So once upon a time, you know, we used to only advertise 1 or 2 brands per quarter. Like in this current Q1, we are advertising 4 brands. We are advertising Caprese, Carlton, Aristocrats, and Skybags Backpack.
No, but if EBITDA is gone up, then it is not increasing at the same rate.
No, sir. What I'm trying to say is EBITDA margin improvement is all from because of gross margin.
Flowing. Yeah, I understand what you're saying.
So
the fixed costs are...
A&P number will be really helpful for full year. What? How much you spend vis-a-vis last year?
That exactly we don't give, but I'm telling you it's a bit more. Like
it comes in annual report. It's just 2 months away. So if you can just help us with the current
numbers. I don't have that handy right now.
Okay. That's it from my side. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Best of luck.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Ravi Naredi from Naredi Investment. Please go ahead.
Can you tell us how much production we are doing and how much we are importing from China?
So we...
Well, it is
we manufacture our hard luggage in India. And we import our soft luggage, a mixture from China and Bangladesh.
And also from India we outsource.
Yeah, and we buy some little bit from India. So overall we can say about half our material is from China.
Half of material outside and half of material in-house.
Not in-house, then from Bangladesh and India. But, I mean, it depends. You call Bangladesh in-house or not. It's in-house in one way, but it's still a foreign country.
Definitely, we are not manufacturing single product in our factory premises.
All our hard luggage is made in India, in our own factory.
Made in India, it's okay.
In our own factories.
Okay, in own factory.
Yeah.
And how much CapEx plan we are planning in next 1-2 years, CapEx?
We are evaluating whether we should increase our Bangladesh capacity. The history of Bangladesh is as follows. You know, we started a few years ago. It was very difficult to get to even the current level of production. You know, so in the year 17-18, then finally we did 57 crores of sales, which was only 15% growth from the previous year. So it's genuinely a very difficult place to manage the raw material cycle, etc., etc. The profitability is decent, but the amount of management effort required is really taxing to achieve this. So we are evaluating whether to set up more factories, and I think we will increase our capacity, but we are still working on how much. So depending on that, that will determine the CapEx. Roughly, we can say for doubling, let's say if we want to double our capacity, it would cost around 20 crores of CapEx.
Okay. And when we will do it?
That is still under consideration by management. How long will it take? Well, that is to be determined.
Okay. Okay, Dilipji, thanks. You have given next 5-year target again 32%, more than 30%, and it will be very good for us, all shareholders. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Tejas Shah from Spark Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for the opportunity and congratulations on fantastic set of numbers. So first question on growth. What we picked up from your opening commentary that growth seems to be secular in nature because all brands are growing, all categories are growing, and apparently whatever numbers we have of your competition, they are also delivering robust numbers on top line. So basically the sectors are actually, the whole sector is actually facing or experiencing the tailwind. And just wanted to understand from your vast experience of more than 3 decades in the sector, when was the last time you experienced this kind of tailwind for the whole sector?
I think around 2010 to 12, you know, when the dollar rate was very favorable, it was to us, it was when the rupee had gone as strong as I think 38, 39 rupees, but it was sort of hovering between 40, 44. And that time our reliance on China was very strong. Safari was quite weak that time. And Safari has definitely in the last 5 years become very strong after Sudhir Jatia he left us and joined there. So in that was a very good period we had. And prior to that, I would say 1992 was, we had some 3-4 years were very good.
So, sir, would you qualify the current momentum more structural in nature versus the previous cycle of 4 years because of this?
Yes, definitely, I think so. It is my own. See, unless, but see, the economy, there are so many uncertainties. And in India, we never had a very smooth run. Right now, I can't think of any adverse things, though the sort of world situation is fairly volatile. Though on the other hand, they said that 2017 was one of the most stable years in world economy. And the stock market volatility index was very, very low. And 2017 was a very, very good year for the whole world. You know, like there was not a single air crash of any commercial airline and so many other factors. Employment was pretty good. Unemployment was very low. So I feel that India is now on a real takeoff stage, and for the secular run, we should have very good times. And there will always be some aberrations for a year or something. I'm talking of next 10 years. Indian economy should be really booming.
Okay. So in the beginning, you mentioned, rightly so, that one of the factors which is helping us is also low penetration, and you quoted a number of 25%. Is this VIP-sponsored or in-house study, or is it the third?
No, this is a general feeling. You see, we don't spend much time or money on all this because it doesn't help us, you know, whether it's 20% or 30%. Our action is going to be the same. So why spend too much money on that research? At the same time, and I'll also add something, a lot of time people ask me, are you gaining share from the unorganized sector? But what happens is when your concentration is so low, just when your penetration is so low, there is always, while you get market share, the unattended sector goes to the people who are not using luggage, they go to the unorganized sector. So both the that sector also grows. So it really doesn't matter, you know, so we don't bother too much about that also, whether how much we are gaining from the unorganized sector. And if there is any strong trends which are adverse to us, then we get to know from the market. But we don't spend much money, any money, I would say, on market research. Our sales field, sales staff and all are enough to know what is happening.
And sir, second question on your margins. Historically, sir, our fourth quarter margins have been way lower than our first quarter margins. This is after perhaps for the first time that that your fourth quarter margins are almost in vicinity of your first quarter margins. So when you mentioned that we'll strive to protect the current level of margins, are we mentioning the exit margins for the year or the overall full year margins that would
be? Well, let me tell you, in this last year, what happened was in the first quarter, in the month of June, our sales collapsed because of GST. So our main sales happened in April and May. And in the middle of June, GST was announced, and so there was a lot. So, and in our business, if the sales top line goes down, then margins come down very much. The net margins are a result of EBITDA and all are a result of top line. And then after the GST, first GST was levied at 28%. Then after it was brought down to 18%, our margins were really sort of, we got back our old margins. So in the quarter, April, January, in the fourth quarter, we got the full benefit of that. Because this GST also came down, I think, in the middle of November. So that way, January to April, March was a very good quarter from that point of view. Our sales also increased quite well. So it was a combination of all these factors.
And just one more aspect. Our overall sales was good in Jan-Feb. Our Q4 sales composition has fundamentally changed. Now we sell a lot of backpacks, and the backpack season is Jan-Feb-March. So one of the reasons historically our margins in Q4 were not that great, our net margins, was because our sales was not that high. But now Jan-Feb-March has become a pretty good, you know, quarter for us in the year.
Sure. And has backpack reached to a level where you believe that from here on continuing the past 2 years of growth run rate will be difficult, or still there's a long runway there?
There's a long way to go. I tell my sales team that as many motorbikes there are in India, we should sell that many backpacks. So it's a long way to go.
That's a good one.
And motorbike costs 30,000-40,000 rupees. Backpack is still 1,000 rupees.
Yeah.
So we should sell 1,000 times more backpacks.
Yeah, that's a good target for sales team this year. So,
sir,
Bangladesh factory, what was the capex done this year in FY18?
It was about 8 crores.
8 crores. And what are we planning incremental in FY19?
So that depends. It could be 10 crores, could be 15 crores.
Okay. And
it depends on the pace at which we can go. So that is the thing.
Sure. And lastly, on Caprese, in opening remarks, we said that Caprese is doing well with good margins. So any threshold you want to share where the brand has reached in terms of size?
I don't want to share a specific number. I can proudly say that we are definitely in the top three ladies' handbag brands in India. It's really well known. If you ask most people in our target group of, you know, young women, young ladies, they've heard of the brand. It's doing well. For us to really reach the next... So it's growing well. But to reach the next threshold, to become as big as some of our luggage brands, I do feel we would have to enter more distribution channels than where we currently are. Right now, we are basically in department stores. We are in e-commerce, and we are in our own stores. We are not present in the dealer channel. The goal originally was that the same dealers who sell luggage, they also typically sell a lot of unbranded or private label handbags, and they would take Caprese. They've not done that. So we are just experimenting or pushing on how can we add that. If we can add that distribution channel in a meaningful way, then we can start hitting that, you know, 200 crore, 300 crore figure. We are still some distance from that.
Is it still below 100 crore brand or about?
It's in that zone.
Okay. And just one clarification. This is homegrown brand, right?
Yes, it is. Yeah. We launched it 5 years ago.
You think it sounds like a European brand?
No, sir, in the advertisement we say that now in India, so I was just confused, where was it before?
Because now it's in India, no? It wasn't in India before we launched it.
Okay. Thanks and all the best. I'll come back in the queue.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Shekhar Singh from Excelizer Capital. Please go ahead.
The point is more like, so what percentage of the total raw material comes from, is foreign currency denominated?
Half. Let's not call it raw material, no, it's a mixture of finished goods and raw material. I mean.
No, I think it's raw material. I think he's referring to raw material, not to finished goods.
So you don't, you mean excluding the finished goods?
No, including finished goods. Huh?
Oh, that makes all the difference.
Half.
Yeah.
50%, okay. And the sick, considering the way currency has behaved in the last few months, do you think there will be some sort of margin compression in the coming quarter?
There is a risk. I cannot say no.
Okay.
But I want to see how the Q1 margins are, depending on that, how we go. Then we can see how big a price increase we have to take. Definitely we'll have to take
Let me say something, that this applies to everybody.
Correct.
To all the players. So the more important point is how much your sales grow. If your sales growth is better by, I mean, if let's say instead of 15%, it's 18%, 19%, then all these things are taken care of.
Okay. And I also want to see how long it's going to be like this. It's not, yeah. I mean, yeah, the trend is not in our favor for sure. Mm-hmm. But is it a 3-month trend? Is it for the full year?
But the expectation is that the rupee will remain at about 67, 68.
Yeah, I know.
You see, what had happened was in 2017, the Reserve Bank artificially kept the rupee strong. And then America complained that you are manipulating. They launched a formal complaint that the Reserve Bank is manipulating the rupee. So that is why they had to let go. And the rupee sort of, because the rupee was the strongest in the international currencies in 2017. So that actually is being made up.
And so what's the outlook on sales for the coming year?
Very good.
Oh, very good will be like in terms of...
very good is good, that's it. Leave it there.
No, let him complete his question.
He wants a number.
Yeah, I'm saying like, will it be in the 15-20% sort of a range, or will it be 10-15% sort of a range?
It's too early to comment. Yeah. It should be 15%.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe a little bit more.
Perfect. Great, sir. Congratulations on a great set of numbers. Thanks.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Ankit Kanodia from Synoptic Solutions. Please go ahead.
Thank you for taking my question. First of all, congratulations for a good set of numbers. What is your strategy for exports? International business is not picking up for long. Any specific reasons for the same? Why are we not focusing on exports?
Yeah, I would like to answer this. Because in India, we get a brand premium. Our brands are well known. We are in market leadership position. Then we can use that scale to keep promoting our brands and to further cement our market leadership position. In the West, there are only few countries, mainly in UAE, where still there's some Indian population who recognizes VIP brand. But we are not outside of just one or two markets in Middle East. We are not the number one, two, or even top three brands. And so there to increase sales, you have to take market share from a strong player. And that is expensive. It's an expensive proposition. So then when we choose our strategic decisions, whether to focus on the Indian consumer market, where we have established strength, competitive advantage, scale, premium, and we also have, you know, a really talented employee pool and people dedicated to the company who can execute our plan in the market. So in the West, or even in, you know, East Asia, Far East, etc., it is difficult to get all of this. So getting the growth in abroad will be much more expensive than getting the growth here.
Right. Fair enough. My next question would be, domestic business is doing good and it has a lot of tailwind. If we have to really think hard and come out with one strong threat or risk for VIP for, say, for the next 2 years, What would that be as per your understanding?
There are only two risks. One is definitely the continued depreciation of the rupee, because while we may evaluate expanding Bangladesh and we make in our own factories in India also, we continue to buy from China, and it is the most steady, consistent base we have. So the continued depreciation of the rupee means that all price increases go towards maintaining or protecting existing margin versus margin expansion. So that's one risk. The second risk is, you know, if Safari continues to grow at the rate they are, then we have to always launch more and more aggressively priced products to counter that. So it puts a bit of, again, price pressure, you know, on the company, which again, so these are the two risks that, I'll not say they are sales growth risks, but they are the risks that prevent us expanding our margins the way we could possibly.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Amar Kalkundrikar from HDFC Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thank you for the opportunity. Can you please share with us what has been the growth rate in backpacks for the full year?
It's high. It's high. Like, it's well above our growth rate for the company. What does it matter what the specific growth rate is?
Okay. Will that be particularly high in Q4? The reason I am asking, madam, is that historically this business has had a seasonality that Q4 sales are typically lower than Q3 sales. But in first time now in this year, Q4 is higher than Q3 by almost 10 percentage points. So
yeah, I think we can expect that to continue.
Okay, that, and that's led primarily by backpacks only.
Yes, yes, yes.
Which has
we launched a new backpack collection in January every year.
Okay, got it. Thank you very much, and all the best for ensuing year.
Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Baidik Sarkar from Unify Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, thanks for taking my question. Congrats on a very strong quarter. So obviously, Caprese, your Skybag backpacks and your luggages have very three different growth drivers.
Mm-hmm.
Could you help us understand, you know, operationally, what have been the market deepening, the channel deepening initiatives you've taken? And in the context of, you know, Mr. Pirmal's strong exit comment on 3X in 4 years and 4X in 5 years, you know, operationally, what do we have to do to get to those kind of numbers?
I think it's just more of the same, to be honest. I mean, we have a very strong channel-wise focus. We have different sales teams for different channels. So we're focusing on distribution in the general trade. We're doing a lot of work on becoming a secondary-oriented company versus primary push. We, I believe, have served hypermarkets very well in the last few years, so we want to continue with that good service. E-com has been an area where the company can improve. We've improved a lot in the last year, but there's room to further improve. So basically having good assortment, managing channel conflict so that there's much less conflict by having exclusive ranges assortment for each channel. That has been one strength area. We want to continue with that. So I think, and then having this good brand architecture also helps. So, you know, we said,
you know, just to, you know, contextualize that better, if you could just help me with some numbers in the sense that, you know,
we don't give specific channel-wise or brand-wise numbers. What we can say is, you know, we expect our sales growth has been good in the last 1 year because we did a few changes on exclusive assortment for each channel. And we can say also in the last 2 years, what we've done is have separate sales teams for each channel. So there's a real channel focus. So that's
so I meant, say, for example, if last year, if you had, say, X thousand retailers, you know, you've added, say, X plus, you know, 1,000 retailers. You know, so numbers in terms of that channel, which could kind of help us understand the initiatives you've taken operationally.
I mean, I've said as much as I think I can. Okay. It's, the, you know.
Sure.
In
terms of your Skybag backpacks, you know, has that breached the 200 crore mark? I mean, just a ballpark of how large you are in that category, because it's a large category by itself. So just to help us understand the numbers
we
better.
We don't give specific brand-wise numbers. Definitely for back, you know, Skybags is our lead brand on the backpacks. So it's a substantial sale.
Okay. And your exports?
Please, sorry to interrupt, but requesting you to please return to the question queue for your follow-up as we have people waiting in the queue.
Sure. Thank you.
We take the next question from the line of Atul Mehra from Motilal Oswal Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon and thanks for the opportunity. Just one question in terms of e-commerce, how much would it be for the industry at this point in time? And similarly, if you would have any kind of...
difficult to comment for the industry. For us, it's less than 10% still, and I feel there's a lot more opportunity.
Right. And how would this number be, say, in the U.S. or something where the e-commerce is more evolved.
So it's high. It's 30%.
Right.
There's a lot of room here to grow.
And so while you focus on your e-commerce, what I observe in terms of on say Amazon and Flipkart, so most of it is through third-party sellers.
That's right.
So would that be the way we would continue, or?
Yes, because you know they are experts in their field, and we see. I mean, if you look at the West, I mean,
yeah. They
really dominate. So we would definitely like to partner with them in the same way that we partner with all channel partners. You know, in hypermarket we partner with all the major retailers.
And do you think there's a room for, say, so given typically you have channel conflicts to do with products and pricing and online and offline, so do you think there would be a need to have an online-only brand for you guys as well, given that this could be something which could get big going forward? So
it's always, you know, I feel we have six brands. Six brands is a good number of brands for a company of our size.
Hmm.
So rather if we can manage through assortment rather than new brand, it's better.
Right. But at this point in time, there's no price difference between online and offline for us.
No, not really. We have different brands for different segments. So some brands are stronger in some channels, you know, because of the pricing of those channels. So, for example, I will say that hypermarkets and e-commerce are probably where the most value products are available. So
right.
Their Aristocrat brand is quite strong.
Right, right. Great, that's it, and wish you all the best. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Kashyap Zaveri from MK FinCap. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. I have a question on your, you know, gross margins. Now, if I look at, you know, FY18 over full year FY18 versus full year 17, there's about, you know, 200 basis points gross margin expansion. How much would you attribute, and this is not adjusting for even, you know, this GST part, there's about 300 basis points expansion. What would you attribute in terms of, let's say, product mix, the price increases that you took, and, you know, the currency depreciation, if you were to split this?
So product mix, I would actually give the least. I will say it's about equal between the price increase and the stronger currency.
And just one clarification, there was some mention about 5-year target. If you could repeat that, I probably missed out the initial comments. Earlier,
chairman?
Some gentleman spoke about 5-year target.
Some gentleman is my chairman of the company.
No, no, in the question. So I am.
Oh.
Okay. I mean.
Yeah, okay. What I had said was. Yeah, let me say. See, our CAGR for PAT for the last 5 years has been 32%.
Right.
Which 32% means in 5 years, you multiply by 4 times. And in 4 years, you multiply by 3 times. So I hope that we can have the same margin, same rate of growth for PAT in the next 5 years.
Okay. Yeah, that's it from my side. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Chirag Lodhia from ValueQuest. Please go ahead.
Ma'am, I have a question on this gross margins. So if you can just help us understand how one should...
Excuse me, sir, I'm so sorry to interrupt, but requesting you to please use the handset mode.
Yeah. I have a question on gross margins. So if you can just help us understand how one should look at FY19 gross margin shaping up. One should focus on last 2 quarters gross margin trends on a full year basis, FY18, what we did, and we should do our own calculation on that number.
How you do your calculation, obviously, I cannot tell you. Look, there's a trend. The trend was positive. It was improving Q3, Q4.
Correct.
Because of GST rates. You know, last year there was a lot of changes. My suggestion is wait for the Q1 results.
Mm-hmm.
They will give a better trend for the GC for the year going forward. Because then we will have had the higher rupee. I mean, the depreciated rupee against the dollar. We will also, you know, and the slightly higher RM costs. Plus all whatever last year's price increases, everything will come out.
Right. And what was cash flow from operation for full year?
That you can work around on the balance sheet is there.
Okay. And any number to distribution expansion we did this year?
So the own, you know, there were two channels where we actually widened our distribution. One is genuine distributors or retailers. So there may be about we added maybe 10% more outlets. And then the second is the hypermarket expansion. That's not where we do it, but they are on their own also growing, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there also it would have been about 10%. For these two channels, but these two channels together make up then about, I will say, about 30% of our business. So then for us, that's only 3%. You see what I'm saying?
These two channels put together is 30% of our business.
Roughly.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Resha Arya from Green Edge Wealth Services. Please go ahead.
Thanks for the opportunity. I just had one question. Wanted to check that is there globally a shift in trend from soft luggage to polycarbonate hard luggage?
Yes, there is. It's very prevalent in East Asia. So in India, if you look at the market, we are about 70-75% soft luggage, 20-25% hard luggage. Of that 20-25% hard luggage, half is still polypropylene and half is polycarbonate. Whereas if you go to Far East markets or European markets, it's actually 50% polycarbonate, 50% soft luggage. So there is so our polycarbonate has been growing. In fact, our polycarbonate growth is offsetting our big decline in polypropylene, which keeps our hard luggage sales the same. And then over a period of time, as the polypropylene goes down to almost zero, it's like briefcases, you know, briefcases are like they've gone down to some level that is almost insignificant. And backpacks are the main thing, not briefcases. So in that same way, polycarbonate keeps growing. It's growing very well, like 20-30% plus. And as it becomes 90% of our hard luggage sales, I see this continuing to grow for next 3, 5, 7 years. It's a very good product, so there's room for growth. It's strong and light. It's strong and light. It's as light as soft luggage, but strong like hard luggage. So it's a very, very good consumer proposition.
So would it be fair to say that in India, the entire luggage industry, polycarbonate hard luggage is growing at a faster pace than soft luggage?
Yes. Yes. For the industry, yes.
So, I mean, in a way, fair to say that, you know, this would be favorable to us because this reduces, over a period of time, as
definitely.
It stands out, it reduces the dependence on the raw material from...
Absolutely. China. It is very good for us. We buy the raw material in rupees, we manufacture in our factories in India. That's good for us.
All right. Thank you so much and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Karan Khanna from Ambit Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. So my question was largely on the gross margins. We've taken 10% price hike in FY18. Secondly, GST rates have been reduced from 28% to 18% in mid-November.
Mm.
And thirdly, you've mentioned that the gross margin expansion that we've seen in 4Q is largely because of currency movement and partly because of the price hikes that we've taken.
Mm.
So is it fair to say that the 52% gross margin that we've seen in 4Q FY18 are not sustainable because...
It will be challenging to maintain them. I can say that. We are striving to maintain them. It is...
Because clearly the price hike that we've taken, so it's a competitive industry, and clearly we'll have to
uh-huh.
sort of cut down the prices. So that's something that...
We're not cutting down the prices, but we may not be able to take price increases to the level we want.
Okay, sure. And secondly, on the cash conversion cycle, so looking at a cash conversion cycle, this is roughly remained the same in both FY18 and FY17, around 75 days.
Mm-hmm.
But if I look at the debtor days, this has increased from 35 days to 46 days in FY18. So what
mm-hmm.
could be the reason behind it?
A lot of our growth is coming from hypermarkets, and their debtor cycle is longer. One is that. And secondly, CSD did not give, so we have slightly high overdue in CSD at the end of Q4. This money is very safe. There's no issues about it.
Mm-hmm.
the government department will get it, but the cycle is a bit longer than we would like. We're working on it. We hope to bring it back in line over the course of the day.
Sure. And if I look at our payable days, so even that has increased from 42 days to 55
That
days.
We can maintain as we are, I think. We will try to endeavor to do that.
Okay. Sure. Great. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you. We take the next question from the line of Tejas Shah from Spark Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, a couple of follow-ups. Backpack category size would be how much and what would be the growth rate for the category, organized one? Mm,
Category size for organized, maybe 1,000 crores, maybe 800 crores.
Okay.
Not fully sure. And growth rate, maybe
30 to 40%.
And this is at retail price level?
No. It's wholesale. This is for the industry, no, you said?
Yeah, industry. Yeah,
yeah, industry at wholesale, not at retail.
So roughly 1,400 crore then?
Yeah, 1,500 maybe.
And,
it's a guesstimate. It's in the guesstimate, yeah.
Sure. Is it fair to assume that your growth rate will be in backpack will be much higher than this 40%? Or you will be gaining market share, right, in this?
No, we are all growing the same. Everybody is penetrating. The main players are American Tourister, ourselves, Safari, and Wildcraft.
So is Wildcraft also gaining market?
I mean, the whole market is growing. I don't know Wildcraft's growth rate exactly. I know our growth rate.
Sure. And I think at this quarter, subsidiary margins are actually not, have not shown the same trend as. So any take on that?
The sales mix was not quite right. So it's not to do with the capacity or the any structural issue. We had, you know, which products sold and which products didn't sell. We feel we could have actually, the factory could have made more. But the demand for those specific products was not. So the solution is for the same, for the factories, for the same capacity to make a wider variety of products.
And that can be done without any major capex? Or?
Yeah, that can be done without capex, but it takes time and management planning, etc. So it just takes time, 6 to 9 months maybe.
Sure. And lastly, on dividend payout, last time we were thinking of rewarding shareholders or increasing payout either through buybacks or some other means. So
No, we were not thinking of any of those things.
Because I think CapEx requirement is not that high and the business is in steady state with there's no working capital stretch either.
We don't find a buyback so attractive at this point. We are happy with our dividend payout policy is be fairly consistent over the years. I agree we have cash on the balance sheet. So we keep it for a rainy day.
Sure. Thanks and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Kamlesh Kotak from Asian Market Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi. Just 1.2 over the side. How much was our CST as a percentage of the total revenue?
It's about 20%.
And how it would have been last year?
Similar lines.
Okay, so that also has gone at least some growth, right?
No, for the year it didn't grow. So, last year maybe it would have been a bit more than whatever, 20 to 23.
All right, fine. All right, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, that seemed to be the last question. I would now like to hand the floor back to the management for their closing comments.
Chairman? Okay, so everybody, thank you. I'm sorry that we started our call a little bit late. It's been a terrific year gone by, and thanks for your support. We're looking forward to another good year ahead. Thank you.